Well, here it is, the very latest from Lotus, the Lotus Turbo Esprit. 150 miles per hour and yours for just £20,000. But you know, this James Bond style of transport is light years away from the very early products from Lotus. And it's now 25 years since Colin Chapman, chairman of Lotus, first designed the dear old Lotus 7. It was stark, uncomfortable and very, very fast. In wet weather, the driver, well, he got wet, I'm afraid. And certainly you could always tell a Lotus 7 driver in the winter because he'd have his bicycle clips on to prevent the wind and rain disappearing up his trouser leg. Goggles, essential, of course, because the wind whips around the side of the screen there and otherwise gives him a permanently watery right eye. Bobble hats, well, quite an advantage because otherwise his hair would be permanently lashing his eyes into blindness. And perhaps most important of all, a plastic cover for his right arm to prevent the slipstream from completely making it soggy. Well, you might be forgiven for thinking that a car that meant so much physical discomfort for the driver would have a very short life indeed. But I'm glad to say that the Lotus 7 is alive and very much kicking and still being made down here in Surrey by Caterham Cars Limited. And very appropriately sitting in one of his Lotus 7s is Graham Nearn, Managing Director of Caterham Cars. And I can see you need to be quite slim to fit into here, Graham, don't you?
Well, you're awesome.
Well, Graham, I'm most intrigued to find out how come Lotus 7s are being built in Caterham.
Well, I took over the manufacturing from Lotus in 1973, but I've got a history going right back with the company because I first started my business career and motoring in the late 50s, early 60s, which is when this car was developed nearly 25 years ago.
So as an enthusiast of many years standing then, what is it about the Lotus 7 that you like so much?
Well, it's got the traditional appearance that harps back to the 60s, but at the same time it's got very modern suspension and road holding. It's a two-seater open car, it's got the ultimate in performance and handling.
What sort of people buy it then nowadays, do you think?
Well, I think they're first and foremost enthusiasts or they would like to learn how to drive a car properly because it is a car that you drive, it doesn't drive you.
What about comfort though? Is it still as lacking as it used to be?
Well, it's an uncompromising sports car, so if we soften the suspension and make it softer, then it's not the same car anymore. But it's a pretty comfortable car to drive now compared to the early days.
Can we have a look inside then and
yes.
See how it's built?
All right, come along.
And how many of these are you able to make each week?
We make about 4 units a week. Some we sell in component form for the UK market. Some we sell fully built for export.
Well, you've been going since 1973, so how many since then, do you think?
Well, we're approaching the 1,000 mark now.
It's quite a lot, isn't it? Are you still able to call them Lotus 7s, even though Lotus aren't building them?
No, it's built under the Caterham banner now. Part of the charisma of the car is the fact that it is what it is, and it wouldn't matter what it was called.
Still Lotus 7 at heart,
yes.
Really. See a bit of the chassis on show there. Has that changed much?
No, it's still basically the same same space frame, immensely strong, very light. We've strengthened the engine bay and relocated the steering geometry and so on.
But the bodywork looks all the same shape. Is that redesigned?
It's still got the natural aluminium, so the whole car is absolutely corrosion-free.
But improvements certainly in the electrics here by the looks of it.
Yes, we've got an aperture there for a heater.
Good idea.
Yes. It's moved on quite a ways since the early days when it just had cycle-type wings. I mean, we now have a hood and much better seating.
So it's much more weatherproof then?
Yes, indeed.
Big hole where the engine should be. Any chance of having a look at that?
Yes, certainly. Well, this is a Ford 1600cc engine, fully warranted.
A Ford engine? Whatever happened to the old twin cam then?
Well, the pattern equipment on the cylinder head finally wore out, but we found with our export markets that there's tremendous demand for a British-made twin cam engine, and with our experience we were able to go along to an engine manufacturer and say, look, this is what we want. And he's come up with a twin cam engine which will be available early next year.
Oh, so you think that would be very popular? Of course, in the old days of the Lotus 7, people used to buy it because it was in kit form and it was nice and cheap, wasn't it?
Yes, well, that was the way that Lotus founded their fortunes, because in those days, by buying it in kit form, it avoided purchase tax. There's unfortunately no way of avoiding VAT and car tax these days, but it does mean that we don't have to do the expensive legislation for national type approval.
So it is, in fact, still in kit form to a certain degree. Does
yes.
it come in a box like it used to?
No, not at all. Anything that concerns safety or anything that's difficult for the purchaser is already done, but he just have to do a final work with his own toolkit.
And how much would you have to pay for one of these now, then?
With a Ford engine, about £5,500 tax paid on the road.
But I suppose they do keep their value, don't they? That's a good thing about
them. They've got
a
very good resale value second-hand, which does underwrite the business.
Mm. Talking about business, I mean, you're a very small fish, aren't you, in a big car-selling pool. Do you think that you've got a future? Will we see Lotus 7?
Well, this is part of the British tradition of sports cars, and having come this far, it will go on forever. We've learned to live with all the difficulties of manufacturing, with the three-day week and an oil crisis, and suppliers going on strike.
So you're very helpful for the future.
I think we're going forever.
Well, with a production rate of just about 4 cars a week, obviously Caterham cars isn't going to make a tremendous impact on the industry's sales. But isn't it nice to know that a tiny little company like this one is still doing very nicely, thank you, producing a totally eccentric and quite delightful sports car that can still show a clean pair of wheels to almost any other car on the road?